So the idea after all these very nice lectures was to end the conference rather than with talks, with a debate. So that's really the idea. So if you have high expectation, you have to make the event good. Because you are expected to participate. We will start with some scatter comments by me, then Riccardo and Alessandro, just to introduce and just to give ideas. When we were choosing the topic of this debate, we thought that naturalness was appropriate, because it's a sufficiently vague subject where everybody has an opinion, and also where everybody has a different opinion, so it looks rather appropriate. So the title, of course, is a kind of a joke. I mean, it's here in Pisa seemed very appropriate, but it's not completely a joke in the sense that I really believe that at this stage, the issue between naturalness and unnaturalness is the issue on the table for the next run of the LHC, and it's not just an issue determining the what will happen about the electroweak scale, but it's much more important because at stake there is really the future strategy of our field as theoretical physicists, but then also as what will be the experimental strategy for the future. You remember that I also found it appropriate because you remember that in the dialogue, in the Galilean dialogue, there are three characters. So the first character is Salviati, and the name of Salviati comes from one of his favorite disciples of Galileo, who is Filippo Salviati. I think my friends from Padova will recognize where this picture is taken. And he is the alter ego of Galileo, who is never mentioned in the dialogue. He's the academician. And he is the bright, intelligent, witty scientist with a vision who knows what's right. And of course, I am Salviati, obviously. And then there is Sagredo. The name of Sagredo comes from a nobleman, a Venetian nobleman, who is a very close friend of Galileo and a protector. He always, you know, really worshipped Galileo, and it was very interesting science, although he was not a real scientist himself. He was the one, for instance, who wrote this beautiful letter to Galileo, trying to convince him not to leave Padova, and mentioning all the fear about going to Florence, but Galileo did not listen. So he really represents in the dialogue the intelligent person, but a little bit outside the issue, because he's not really a scientist, so he doesn't have a position, but he poses the right question, and then he answers the question, and this will be Riccardo. Then there is a third character. The third character is Simplicio. Now, you don't need to know much Italian to understand that although Galileo says that he comes from Simplicius of Cilea, who was a commentator of Aristotelian commentator, he's really the dumb Aristotelian, peripatetic philosopher who does not see what the future is, insists with the old version, and who better than my friend Alessandro Stumia could play the part. Of course, I think there will be a twist in the story at the end, because contrary to the dialogue, it's quite possible that at the end there will be Simplicio who will show that the other two are idiots and he is the only one right. So I don't know what he will say. I mean, this is a surprise. We really did not prepare anything. We did not talk to each other because we wanted to have a spontaneous discussion. So in my few minutes, I just want to talk about one paper. I want to talk about this contribution by Riccardo on naturalness. This is the cover of the CERN preprint, of the original CERN preprint. You see the old style. I think it's very nice. This was written in the summer of 1987. It was, for me, it was really extraordinary experience, I have to say. It was my first exposure. By the way, this was my first visit to CERN. Little I knew that I would have spent a lot of time there at that time. It was also the first time in which I met Riccardo Rattazzi, and then it was a long friendship. He was my dearest friend at that time, and that was the first time that I met, and he gave indirectly contribution to this paper because he was discussing. But not only if it really changed my life, but it changed the life of one other person in the world that you may not know. And because after we finished this paper, I went on vacation, and I went on vacation with a friend of mine who was in undergraduate school with me. We actually did many exams. We studied many exams together. He was a really bright, brilliant guy. And you know, we were both in graduate school deciding what to do and so on. And we took the Grand Randonnée in Corsica. So 7 days, the two of us walking. So, of course, you know, you talk. There's nothing else to do. You talk. And I was telling him. I was very excited about this. And so I was explaining to him what we did, why I thought it was important, what was the vision. And, you know, and then at night, and the tent is dark, and I still explain to him all the things. And then the second or third day, he stopped and said, you know, I'm sure that this thing must be very important because I see how excited you are. But to me, it really looks dumb. And then he said, maybe just because I don't understand physics, maybe I should switch. And as soon as he came back, he went into mathematics. Now he's a professor of mathematics in Turin. So I think this paper had a good effect of somebody understanding that physics maybe is not the field. I want to praise this paper. It may sound a little bit inappropriate that I do that, but I don't think it is, for the frank and candid reason that all the idea and the merit, if there is a merit in this paper, really comes from Riccardo. I really participated only as a student. And I want to show that in this paper, there is a vision that many people don't really see. Most of the people just see this formula, right? There is a formula in which you can compute the criterion and quantify the degree of naturalness, and there have been many, many analyses based on that. But I think there's much more on that. In order to understand, we have to go back at that time. So naturalness at that time, of course, was a well-known concept, but essentially was influenced, and there were many papers, but influenced by the vision of Tuft. And in his paper he says, it is unlikely that the microscopic equations contain various free parameters that are carefully adjusted by nature to give canceling effects such that the macroscopic systems have some special properties. So he saw this connection between a large scale and a small scale. So there is a separation, if you wish, in a Wilsonian way of scales, and you want to make sure that what happens in the UV cannot be, what happens in the IR cannot be critically depend on the details or the variation of the parameters in the UV. So in this concept, there is the idea is that if you see in the RG space of trajectory, in order to be close to a point where there is a small parameters, either you can be there, but your trajectory is extremely unstable from changes to what happens in the UV, or you are close to a point of enhanced symmetry. And then your RG trajectory somehow remains close to the point. So the basis of Tuft was to connect the idea of naturalness to symmetry. So like it or not, this is the point of connecting naturalness to symmetry because points of enhanced symmetry are special, and connecting the idea of naturalness to the RG flow, because what you're looking is the RG flow and see the stability of that. This was a view, and I think it was very much misinterpreted by many, because Because, of course, he described it in the correct language, which was effective theories. And the point comes up with quadratic divergences. And then there were endless of discussion about, oh, but, you know, quadratic divergences, it depends on regularization. You're talking about a non-physical object because of the cutoff. Well, we all know what the story is, but I just want to show one plot that the academician showed you know, Salviati was, as Andrea said, Salviati in his dialogue never refers to Galileo directly, but he always says the academician. So Ricardo showed this in a recent Nobel meeting, which shows the RG evolution of the Higgs mass in a theory in which you put some new state at an intermediate scale. So obviously there is a large threshold correction that appears at this intermediate scale. And so in order to land in the IR to the correct value, you have to make a very precise adjustment of the UV properties in order to match what happens to the various matching condition in the intermediate scales. So this is a way to show that all these issues about quadratic divergence, regularizations are, in the words of Galileo, una solennissima coglioneria. This was a letter that, this is taken from a letter by Galileo, in which he explains his point of view against a book that was written objecting to the discussion of the Sidereus Nuncius. And I just, the way that Galileo just slaps in the face this author and uses the language, I don't know why, but it reminded me of... okay. So what I want to say is that there was something, maybe a little subtle, maybe it's not so crucial, but very, very important in what Ricardo said, in what Ricardo did. Because what he changed the story was from an RG evolution to an evolution in theory space. Seems just a small difference, but there is a important difference at the end that you'll see. So the idea, as you know, is to take now, don't talk about the divergences, but to have a supersymmetric theories where, if you wish, it's a kind of a physical regulator of quadratic divergences. And what you do is you vary the parameters of your theory, and you want to know, as you vary these parameters, what happens to the weak scale. And by doing this, by requiring that this sensitivity should not be more than 10% at that time, he obtained these bounds on the various supersymmetric masses. Now, this idea of varying in theory space, if you think, is exactly what is done, but time is not important. This is an open discussion. So it is, but I'll respect it. This idea of varying in theory space, if you think, it's exactly what is done now when Lorentz and the others talk about what happens in the multiverse when you scan parameters and so on. So it's quite curious that the naturalness criterion was defined in a setup which, sorry to tell you, but it looked exactly like the multiverse. So are we really defining now naturalism in what other setup? I mean, if you think of one single theory, the whole point does not emerge. A few other things. I mean, I don't know if you've seen it. Oops, going back, it's impossible. But you've seen that those bounds have some cusps, some points in which they go very large. So what happens? In order to understand, let me just show you one equation. So this equation here is the expression of mz as a function of all possible supersymmetric parameters in the minimal model, treating them, all these are the coefficient of the soft masses at some large scale, some unification scale. I'm fixing for simplicity large time beta. Now we know the top mass. So all these coefficients are completely fixed. And you see that there are many, many, many units. What I want to point out of this, first of all, let me just for simplicity focus on the most important ones. The most important ones are the one proportional to the Guino mass, the one proportional to mu, and the one proportional to the Higgs mass, and to the left and right stop. And you see that these coefficients are of order one. Now, this is, you know, right now it's well known, it's digested, but I think this was not appreciated in the late 80s. Because in the late 80s, people were really thinking, okay, you know, you take a one loop factor, and so supersymmetry has to be smaller, so the mass, let me say, the bound is alpha divided by 4 pi lambda squared, and that lambda are the mass of the supersymmetric particles, and therefore you get a factor of 4 pi divided by g with respect to the 2mz, and this brings you to the TV. This was really the standard law, and Ricardo showed that the natural scale within this set of theories is mz, is not the TV. And indeed, if you take this formula and you just look what is the contribution of the gluino to, so just one single contribution, of course there could be cancellations, to mz square, you find that already a gluino 400 GV gives a contribution which is 10 times bigger than the physical value. So that was, by the way, no, this would violate the criterion. So that, I think, is a concrete numerical aspect which is very important. Second point is that it was noticed in that paper that universality is special. Take these three numbers and sum them, okay? So these are numbers of order one. When you sum them, you get 0.03, 3%. Actually, if I take the sum of all these last four lines, which are all the contribution of the various scalars with large tangent beta, I'm getting something which is 1%. So there is actually a cancellation of two orders of magnitude from the natural value, because you see these are really order one, to the total contribution. And these are the zeros, these cusps that you find. And it so happens that now that we know that the top mass, we just live very close to this special cancellation. Does it have a meaning? Does that mean that maybe, you know, supersymmetry is less tuned than what we were expecting? This issue was addressed in that paper, and that paper said, well, you know, if I start varying now other parameters, there was, you know, the Yukawa coupling of the top at that time, but you can also think, you know, if I vary from my hypothesis of universality, I just move around, this will just go away. But again, this is exactly the question that we have now. Which parameters can? When you take this argument about naturalness, do you take them using universality without using universality? Do you also vary Yukawa's or not? And again, it was rediscovering the question that we have now. And all this problem about, you know, how fine-tuned is are exactly the same problem of what is the measure in the multiverse. So in the abstract of this paper, Ricardo says, these bounds give an objective criterion to test or disprove the idea of low-energy supersymmetry as implemented in supergravity models. Well, you got the answer, okay? So now LHC gave you the answer, and it was disproved. But notice that already in the abstract, he says, as implemented in supergravity models. The crucial thing was this large log to get this coefficient under one. So what the LHC has excluded is a certain class of theories, and have they excluded, but we have now to see what it means, and especially, you know, most now there is a lot of games of trying to define classes of supersymmetric theories which are less tuned, which are more natural. Most of the time, this choice corresponds exactly to find certain relations, like the one that I was showing, or relation, for instance, with when you go close to maximal stop mixing, where the bound from the Higgs mass becomes looser. But those, exactly in the language that Ricardo was using, most of the time imply a tuning in theory space, which is much larger than the tuning in the weak, in the electroweak scale. And this is really already pointed out here. So all this to say that, I mean, Ricardo really had a vision and anticipated the time, but now we are really testing, crucially, this idea, which will be determining for our future.
Okay.
This is,
since time is not important, as long as we catch the bus.
You won't have quite, we have a question altogether at the end. I think
maybe
it's better.
Better to have the, yes.
Oops.
Ricardo.
Aspetti che apro. Okay, so since I'm the outsider, Sagredo, I mean, don't expect much from me. Okay. So this is just an outsider viewpoint on the hierarchy problem, and it's probably not an outsider, but I view myself as an outsider in all this, and a recollection. So it's a bit not what you may expect. So what does the master say? So nothing better than the words of the master epitomize what our discipline is. Okay? Elementary particle physics is the quadrant of nature whose laws can be written in a few lines with absolute precision and the greatest empirical adequacy. Well, we know very well what is the origin of this simplicity, these few lines, and this absolute precision is in the principles that underline quantum field theory. And these principles mean mostly locality, symmetry, and to a less fundamental level, but to a significant amount less fundamental, but sufficiently relevant, renormalizability, which I indicate in a gray shade. Now, symmetry, there are two types of symmetries, there's gauge and global, and we know very well that gauge symmetries are just the way we couple spinning objects to each other, preserving locality, while global symmetries are, in a sense, they're an option. And they're, in a sense, an option, as you may or may not agree, that is, in a sense, an accident, and it's very much related to renormalizability. And let me explain why. And the connection and the role of global symmetries and normalizability in the simplicity has to do, to some extent, with the hierarchy problem. This is just what I want to say. So let me just very simply how I would explain what we are doing to somebody outside physics, since I'm Sagredo, I'm always dealing with priests. So symmetry and renormalizability. So take a cow, look at it from nearby. The cow is not invariant under rotations. But if you go far away, you've probably with long wavelength, there you have. Okay, you have a point like cow, it's invariant under SO3. Okay, it's just an accident of the fact that you're far away or that your tools have too long wavelength. And that's the story, basically the story behind the sentence, in my opinion, what Ricardo is saying there. So take the standard model Lagrangian. We know, okay, we know the principles. What are the gauge symmetries? What are the particle content? And then you write the most general Lagrangian. This is what you would do, for instance, in ADD. Write all the junk you can think of, okay? Not saying that ADD is junk, okay? And this Lagrangian has everything. It has no symmetry whatsoever, globally, especially. So you turn it around, it has no symmetry. But if you go far away, like the cow, this becomes a point-like Lagrangian. This is what we call a normalizable Lagrangian. And very much like the cow became spherically symmetric, this Lagrangian develops a set of symmetries. And it's amazing that this set of symmetries, okay, let me remind you what they are, baryon number, lepton numbers, okay, minimal flavor violation. You know what I mean, right? There is an SU3 to the fifth, which is only broken in a very peculiar way. You should call this gene. I was surprised that Mayani this morning called minimal flavor violation this rather than Jim, but I would call it Jim, but since now it's called minimal flavor violation, I call it this way. SU2 custodia, all these, they are the accidental symmetries. So the standard model is a spherical cow as the symmetries. And what is really remarkable, is structurally remarkable, that these are precisely those symmetries that we observe in nature. It's just what we observe. And the simplicity and the success of a standard model have very much to do with this. Now, where does the hierarchy problem come? It comes in the fact that this picture is at the time very compelling, very convincing, and at the same time absurd. Okay? And we know why it's absurd. It's absurd because, well, there is a part in the Lagrangian, which you can call the potential, where when we send the cow, when we try to make our cow point-like, the cow wants to come back, okay? And we know, well, okay, there's the cosmological constant. That's the biggest possible cow. It's an elephant. And the Higgs mass. And in other words, if we want to get all these nice features, we have to swallow some very small numbers in stark violation of dimensional analysis, or if you want to be, formal, scale symmetry selection rules. Okay, this is one side of the problem, one side. On the other side, the problem manifests in the following way, that as soon as we try, and 3-4 decades of work in particle physics are really now making this, to my opinion, into a principle, all theories that are natural are all structurally distinguished from the standard model and hence from nature. And there's no doubt, most of us, have made a career in trying precisely to overcome this vertical wall. I mean, all the theories beyond the standard model have problems with baryon, lepton, and flavor. Take, for instance, supersymmetry. The fact that the supersymmetry has scalars, scalar matter, changes completely the picture of baryon, lepton, and flavor violation. Take technicolor, the fact that that the Higgs is dimensionful, has a dimension bigger than the Higgs field, has a dimension bigger than one, puts flavor unwanted flavor violation and Yukawa coupling precisely on the same ground. So what we see and what we don't see becomes of the same type. And the only theory that really has the features that are encoded in our observation of the world is the standard model. This is truly and. But the standard model has this problem. So this is essentially the hierarchy problem. It's truly a paradoxical situation where nothing seems to work. True, we came up with theories like gauge mediation that try in a clever way. But there's always something that doesn't sound completely convincing. Now, to me, the experimental program we are dealing with is just the biggest thing we are trying to do. And we have to be honest with us. I mean, at least I see it this way. And I think it's a defendable program, is to decide between these two broad scenarios, okay? The standard model is the right description up to a very high scale, and we have lots of indications, axiom physics, neutrino masses, unification, gravity, that the scale where new physics may come may be very, very high. And this is beautifully simple and very unnatural. And the contrary is that we have the standard model replaced by supersymmetry or composite, not far above the weak scale, or at the weak scale. This is certainly going to be natural, but not nearly as beautiful or as simple as the standard model. It's always going to be clever. So none of this is convincing, but one of the two must be true. And let's say if it is, it's clear that, as Nima pointed out, if the first option is where we go, this is going to be a big paradigm shift. How do we truly make sense of this? Well, so far, and perhaps that's all we will end up with, we have been thinking in terms of anthropics, theory space. Perhaps that's the way we would end up in this situation. But who knows where we would go. And in fact, thinking about theory space, this brings me back to the summer of 87, when the summer that Jan was referring to before. It was a great summer for me as well. I was an undergrad. I followed my advisor at CERN to complete my diploma work. And it was a great time. I was learning every day a lot of stuff on my own and also talking to Ricardo. And there are several things I could say about that summer, but there are two things that are very much related to naturalness in my mind. The first is that I was invited, and I was elated by that, to dinner at Ricardo's place. It was a great dinner, especially thanks to Gabriella's ability in the kitchen. And Ricardo wanted to compete with Gabriella, so he insisted in preparing something on the grill. He bought some rognon, some kidney, I don't know whether it was veal kidney, at the market, and he wanted to grill it. It was clearly the first time he was doing that. He evidently did not have enough charcoal, and so the rognon was on the fire for probably 2 hours, and then we had to eat it. He probably should have stayed another 2 hours on the fire, because there was basically no fire. And it was a rognon, it was not completely cooked. So it tasted like uncooked kidneys, okay? And but Ricardo was telling me, Bischero, this is a delicacy, you must eat it. So I just ate it. I mean, it tasted weird, but I said, look, if all the gourmet, in particular my advisor, think this is what a real good tasting thing is, I must eat it. So I ate it. Okay, I ate it all of it. At the same dinner, there was this other guy, this student, all very excited, who was going around the barbecue saying, it looked like a very excited operator, stock operator, was coming all these numbers, Chargino 200, Guino 400, and Ricardo was taking notes. And, okay, this guy didn't even touch the kidneys, okay? He said, no, that's for you. I mean, I'm not going to do that. But he was so taken by this very exciting project about putting bounds on these supersymmetric particles. So, well, okay, I didn't dare ask him that night. I had already eaten a kidney, so, I mean, I was happy. So I waited the day after, so I asked him what all this was about, and... Well, he explained in detail this project about naturalness, how to put bounds. Well, at that time, I was very mathematically minded, and like his friend, and that what he was telling me didn't taste like physics, okay? I mean, you say, what the hell? But then I told myself, but look, if these smart people are doing this stuff, then I clearly must do it, and that's how I started a career on naturalness. And I'm happy I don't regret. I'm happy I didn't become a mathematician. Okay, and as John already said, what I was planning to say, this paper is still here, haunting us, is still giving us the vision for the future, for what our Marco Polo friend wants to propose the Chinese to do, right? I mean, trying to see what there is up to 100 TV. I mean, and what Ricardo was considering as acceptable or unacceptable, now we see it as a feature. Well, I mean, we can be 1% or 10% or 1 per mil away from the dangerous, from the critical point separating broken and unbroken supersymmetry, broken and unbroken electroweak Loic parameters, but that's still, and if you see good work in physics, continues with a life of its own. In fact, as Gianni said, this work could have been interpreted in modern, if you want, well, okay, say it as you wish, more modern or not, in terms of a landscape with no preference, with no distribution, in other words, with no preference for high-scale breaking, so that you have a flat distribution. And according to Ricardo, according to this picture, you would expect to be here, here, or here, and not there. Of course, if you have a probability growing in that direction, then you're pushed to the boundary. This is what Larry was showing before. It's interesting that at the same time, in that very same month, another paper came out, the paper by Weinberg, and there he was dealing exactly, well, with a similar question, and then he was trying to come up. Yeah. Oh, sorry. So that's basically all I had to say. And now, my hope is still that we get something else, and not just the landscape for this, not just anthropics. But that's, if that's the way it is, that's the way it is. But in this sense, any attempt to escape the landscape, even if dumb and even if completely wrong, is still worthy of our attention and of our discussion. And then with this statement that I leave the next speaker.
Male. No, ce l'ho. Okay, so unlike the previous speakers, I removed all the cows, all the jokes, and now to give a serious talk. So a talk about physics, in particular I will talk about finite naturalness, so maybe the whole talk is a joke. Again I start from this paper. Okay, I was underage, not undergraduate, so. And this was a very strong argument for supersymmetry, and one of the most famous predictions of one of these two authors. If Susie is not discovered at LEP, I will cut my desk. So. No jokes. No, I am not. I am totally serious. So with Ricardo, we wrote about 26 papers, and after many papers, we wrote the proceeding, which is this lab paradox. In writing it, we had some fights because we had different answers. In practice, I applied the prediction. After this paper, I stopped working on Susie, which of course is very good for your career. Okay, so I will not summarize what you already know. So there is a very beautiful scenario built by theorists. You are natural, Susie, MSSM, supergravity, constraint, blah, blah, very beautiful. The experimental situation now has been, for example, is discussed in papers by Villadoro and others. I will say today one could dare to do this opposite prediction. So, this is my.
I am learning, I can't take
this anymore. you don't lose anything if you do it twice. Okay, so the goal of this serious talk is to discuss that maybe there is one more possibilities beyond the two discussed sistemi massimi, blah, blah, blah. So to start, I have a slide that Ricardo likes a lot. Every time he sees this slide, he gets nervous. Okay, so Gian and Ricardo discussed these two possibilities. I will try to discuss the third one. So the idea is that maybe naturalness is right, but in a modified form, where basically quadratic divergences are ignored. Would you agree with this sentence?
What?
Would you agree on this sentence?
So it's pretty clear what you said about the attendance. Your attendance, of course, is completely understandable.
So you took, in fact, at the course of the time, you agree with that. Okay, so. No, Ricardo does not like this statement, but actually this is from a paper with all Slava and Ricardo. Okay, so the idea is that maybe this quadratic divergence is zero, because there is some unknown physical cutoff with this property, for example, like in dimensional regularization. Okay, since people like Galileo, this is a quote of Galileo when he was jailed for talking about some wrong topic. In the standard model, this property is true, non-trivially. So this is Higgs mass, top mass, we are here. In this point, this modified fine-tuning is small, like Barbieri and Jan were dreaming in 87. Had the X mass been different, even the standard model would have fine-tuned from this modified point of view. What about new physics? So if the standard model is extended with two heavy particles too much coupled, then this idea is dead. So in this context, unlike in the usual context, high-scale model building is very constrained. So you cannot do GATT, you cannot do flavor models. Basically, this idea is that maybe the top is the top. If the top really is Ragli, the heaviest particle in nature, there is no issue about the hierarchy problem. If there is only the weak scale, the hierarchy problem is solved. It does not even exist. So one issue is that we know from experiment that new physics exists, dark matter, neutrino masses, blah, blah, blah. So one question is, what about this new physics? This is the answer. In each case, you have bounds on the scale of new physics. Typically, it is constrained to be around the weak scale. You can even do axioms. You can even put an absolute bound on the mass of any particle from gravitational loops. Dark matter, I have no time to show prediction and plots. Okay, I'm trying to be very fast because you need the bus. So what could be the origin of the weak scale in this context? So maybe, just so, maybe the weak scale could be the gravitational shadow of a particle with this mass, because if you compute this three-loop Feynman diagram, any scalar gets a mass of Ragli, the weak scale. So it could work in this way. In the next slide, I present a more dynamical model where the weak scale arises from nothing, just like the QCD scale. So the goal of the model is generate dynamically the weak scale and the dark matter at the weak scale, preserve the good features of the standard model, baryon, number, flavor, blah, 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 get dark matter stability in the same way, as an automatic feature without imposing it by hand. And the model is these two lines. I am the one who wrote you can do in one line. So the model is just a standard model plus one extra SU2. The only new particle is a scalar doublet under the extra SU2. And this is at all the Lagrangian. The potential is X quartic, no X mass because I want to get it. So I put zero to start. Same thing for the other scalar and the mixing term. You do quantum corrections, the couplings run, the quartic of the other scalar becomes negative at some scale via Coleman-Weinberg. At this scale, you get a VEV for the other scalar and for the X. So you dynamically generate the weak scale as the scale where a coupling becomes negative. So flavor is okay. I add the non-new Yukawas. The vectors of the area SU2 get a mass. They are automatically stable. Just it follows from the Lagrangian. So they could be dark matter. Furthermore, the quartic of the Higgs remains positive, unlike in the standard model, where it seems to get a bit negative. Experimental implications of this model. So there is one extra physical scalar S, which basically acts like the Higgs of the Higgs. It is the particle who gives mass to the Higgs. Furthermore, you have dark matter. You can compute the thermal abundance. In this model, there is no Z2 symmetry, so there are also semi-annihilations that contribute. You get something, and this is the relation between the parameters such that you get the correct abundance of dark matter. Now you have one free parameter, for example, this one. You can predict everything. Everything is the mass of the extra scalar, its cross-section at the Large Hadron Collider, the mass of dark matter, and the cross-section for dark matter. This model predicts that you must be along this line. So if you measure one, for example, if this is true, there is extra hint in data around this mass, then we must be here. So we predict that the extra, the cross-section. So color is blue. Here, this is the prediction for dark matter. As a curiosity, in this model, the electric phase transition is first order, so in some range of parameters, it also predicts some gravitational wave, potentially detectable. If you want to get the bus, we can go. Now, there is the bad part. My. Okay, so well, maybe all of this is wrong, if you can prove that this is true. Nobody knows if this is true. Maybe the 1 over M Planck is just a small coupling. So it is not a big mass, it is a small coupling. So maybe there are no new particles around the Planck mass. This happens in a model by Dubosky in two dimensions. So what can you do? First assumption, assume that gravity, the true coupling of gravity is everywhere small with respect to the standard model couplings. So you can go with the RG of the standard model above the Planck mass. Problem, you encounter Landau poles for hypercharge, possibly quartic of the Higgs, possibly top UWA coupling. So does it happen or not? Here I summarize the procedure. You take any model and you can solve RG up to infinity. So the procedure is write the RG, insert these ansatz. Coupling goes to zero as 1 over inverse of logarithm of energy. RG becomes a system of ordinary equation in these constants. You solve, you get multiple solutions, typically maybe 1,000 of solutions if you have 10 RG. If, no. Eh? There is no G Newton here. Here I'm assumption one, no G Newton. Next slide, you will have G Newton. Okay, so if at least one, if you have many solutions, if for at least one of them all couplings are real, then the solution is physical and the model can reach infinite energy. What happens in the standard model? Well, of course, there is the Landau pole for hypercharge, so the only solution has zero hypercharge. What is interesting is that you predict the top Yukawa coupling. So this requirement predicts some couplings. The prediction is 194 GeV for the top mass in the limit where there is no hypercharge, sorry. And it also predicts that lambda must become negative at large energy. It happens in the standard model. So this is just to show something that you have never seen in your life. A plot with a double logarithmic axis. This is how it could work if the hypercharge were zero. Unfortunately, it is not zero, so you have this big problem, Landau pole at 10 to 43 GeV. This is the biggest problem in physics. So what can you do? You can try to extend the standard model into a theory with no abelian U1. So you can do SU5, but then you must be the gut scale. This is not compatible with finite naturalness. You can try different groups, and I believe there are only two of them that could be at the weak scale. However, unfortunately, Riccardo teaches us to look at experiments, and there are some stupid experiments about kaons that push the mass of these vectors to 10 TeV. So, how can I criticize supersymmetry if at the end I do something more fine-tuned? So this is very bad. To try to get a hope, you must try to involve quantum gravity. This is next slide. So this is last slide. So maybe the full theory is this one. So maybe the right idea is that the full Lagrangian has no dimensionful couplings. This is what Ratazzi was telling. Blah, 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 all beautiful, except for the two-dimensional couplings. So maybe this is the right way of understanding nature. Then gravity will be this, not R, but R square, and there are two allowed terms, this one and this one. You can get the Planck mass as the VEV of a scalar that gets a VEV because a quartic becomes negative. In this model, the graviton propagator is 1 over p to the 4th, because R squared has 4 derivatives. So the theory is renormalizable. You can compute the RG and try to see what happens. So you can get the Planck mass. There is a little detail. I have no time to discuss. Interesting feature. Inflation is not a typical outcome of field theory. Typically, potentials are not flat. One special model that gives flat potential is quartic, no nothing else, with a small coupling to gravity. So this automatically is a model of inflation. compatible with Planck data. You can compute the beta function, the gravitational correction to the beta function of hypercharge. So sometimes now gravity gives zero, and unfortunately, you get zero. So you don't avoid the Landau pole. Yes, probably yes. The hidden reason is this one. But you get zero as a cancellation between two diagrams, rainbow and tadpole. So not a stupid zero. Okay. So far it doesn't seem to work very bad. So I should conclude. We heard many of the understand the questions, go to the root. Better to be right than be clever. So despite this talk, one other lesson from Ricardo was avoid crackpot physics. Thank you.
We still have some minutes for a short discussion.
Trying to put the different talks together, I sympathize somehow with the fact that the fact that the lack of naturalness occurs in these relevant operators. I don't think we can ignore completely the fact that there are divergences, quadratic and quartic divergences, and I know my own feeling is that in nature there shouldn't be any divergences. I mean, the true theory should be divergence-free. So, in my opinion, the true theory, theories need ultraviolet completions, and then the question I have in mind is whether this naturalness discussion is affected by the ultraviolet completion itself. I mean, can you just vary the low energy parameters and check what Ricardo was saying, the sensitivity of the infrared with respect to these parameters that we measure, or do you have to take into account the fact that the ultraviolet completion can also enter in the fine-tuning issue? I mean, we have seen from Jan that if you combine different variations of different parameters, you can reduce the fine-tuning. So my question is whether some ultraviolet completion parameter can play a role in this discussion.
I don't know if I made myself clear. So just to answer, it's always possible, but it's the words by Toft. I mean, that means, as I was showing you that plot, right? It is possible, but the UV theory must know of all the parameters of the infrared and adjust according to those parameters. If you accept that something like that happens, it means that you have an interplay of completely different scale, UV infrared, which really goes against our effective field theory intuition, in which you can separate and the various scales. It is possible. It is all, of course, we cannot exclude it, that there is a theory that knows of all the scales simultaneously. But that's why I'm saying it's a big change in the paradigm. Because always in the paradigm, we have this idea that we can use effective field theory, and then we can solve atomic physics without knowing the details about the quarks. And in that case, what you are telling me is that there is a possibility in which you cannot separate scales in the sense that parameters are correlated and they know each other.
I'm not saying that. I mean, certain quantities you can know. I guess what I'm saying is that the ultraviolet theory can be much more complicated than just the field theory itself. I mean, take string theory. You go to the cutoff. You have infinite. Gotcha. So there is no simple.
target scale particles. Who cancels those? Either you take the approach of Alessandro, saying there's nothing in between. But if you accept that there is one particle 10 to the 10 GeV, that particle, if it is coupled to the Higgs, will give a finite correction which is proportional to 10 to the 10 GeV.
Yeah, but then
and then you have to cancel it and then you
can the complete theory, too. But that's kind of computing correction. In the complete theory, the Higgs mass is what it is, right? If you put everything together, and I mean, this thing of correction.
Appearance.
So what would happen is that you try to recomplete the theory, and the recompletion has
actually field theories are not good enough to compute relevant operators.
Okay. But that's a big change in paradigm, you know, right? Because we are dropping one of the tools that we've always used.
It doesn't work. Since it doesn't work,
so, but no, you should know there are people who are working on this, like Pranath Gordykane. No, Dubovsky is not along this line. Is a theory where there is nothing at the Planck scale. So there are no cancellations, there is just nothing.
That theory is solved, it has one mass
factor. Okay.
Once the theory is solved, you cannot see any cancellation. I don't see what you mean.
Yeah, okay.
In that theory,
yes.
In that theory at the high scale, the fact that it's like you see, but you see some scale, mm-hmm. You see that something is different than the case where things must be. There are some small parameters in the amplitude scale that you see.
Okay.
There is a small parameter. It's just a
wait,
parameter.
So the message that I want to give is not that this is right, but that along this direction, that is usually ignored, there could be something right. So let's look at it.
I have three quick comments. So first, all the discussion about the hierarchy problem boils down to feelings in theories where the Higgs mass is not calculable. So if we just take the standard model, the Higgs mass, the mass squared parameter is not calculable. It's a perfectly legitimate attitude to take. Screw the hierarchy problem, forget about it, take it from experiment. That's fine. Okay? It's the hierarchy problem becomes completely sharp and is totally sharp in a context where you find a bigger UV theory where the Higgs mass becomes calculable. And it is interesting that every single theory anyone has ever come up with which makes the Higgs mass calculable, you see the precise analog of the hierarchy problem as you'd expect from the low energy point of view. For example, the Higgs is a pseudo-Goldstone boson, like the charged pion. Okay, you build such a theory. The Higgs mass is calculable, pow. You see that to make the Higgs much lighter than the rest of the spectrum requires a tuning in the underlying theory. Or you make the Higgs the fifth component of a gauge field, or you embed in a supersymmetric theory, or you put it on a lattice, which is where it came from to begin with, right? In every single example anyone has ever come up with where the Higgs mass becomes calculable, now it's not a question of feelings. In bigger ultraviolet theories where the Higgs mass squared becomes calculable, you see the hierarchy problem, and what we see from the low energy point of view, from the usual discussions, is approximately correct. So that's comment number one. Related to that is something else, which is it could be, and no one has found an example like this, but it could be that you find a UV completion where the Higgs mass is calculable and the coefficient out in front that comes out of the underlying theory is a big number or a very small number. This is not unheard of. It happens in pure mathematics all the time, that you can set up a simple sounding question with no big or small numbers, and out pops a large number. So, you know, you're looking for functions that map the SL2Z invariant functions that map the fundamental region into the complex plane. It's a question with no big or small numbers anywhere, and yet the number 196,884 pops out. Okay, that's the mathematics is remarkable in that way. Large numbers can come out of questions which don't have large numbers in them. And if someone could come up with a computation of the Higgs mass in a bigger theory where the Higgs mass squared is related to the heavy states in the theory by the coefficient the of 1 over q in the expansion of the j function in the thing that we just said, that would be amazing. We'd have an explanation of why the Higgs mass might be square root of 196,884 times lighter than the next scale. It's just that in every example, right, exactly. So that's right. So you need some, so it's conceivable. Just no one has ever found one, right? No one has ever found one. And I think if you ask in ancient times, what fantasy people had in mind for the cosmological constant, they had some fantasy like this in mind, some crazy, fascinating UV structure that removed the problems. The same fantasy could also be true for the Higgs. It's equally unconcrete for the Higgs as it is for the cosmological constant. But it's an open possibility. It's possible that we might find some such UV theory. And, you know, in order to save our problems, we don't need 10 to the 32 to come out. It could just be the underlying theory for a good reason gives us large numbers like this. Mathematics does this, okay? So the final comment I want to make is about the Planck scale. And it's just the very simple fact that's been said many times. Gravity is not a random UV theory. Gravity is not a random UV theory. Unlike unlike most non-normalizable theories, we know an awful lot about the spectrum of gravity at very, very high energies. So we know there are particles up there. We know that if we take, you know, a mass 1,000 M Planck, it's a, you know, nice semi-classical black hole. We let it evaporate for a while, it gets lighter and lighter. There are particles out there, and we know for a fact that they're there. You believe the neutron stars are there? You believe that smaller black holes are there? What do you think happens to those black holes? At what point do they go from being big, massive objects to something else? Okay. So we know that there's a semi-classical spectrum of states that are heavier than the Planck scale. Unlike random UV theories, which we don't know that for, gravity is special. We know a lot about the high energy structure.
So you want to argue that it must be in this way?
Well, since I don't want to talk about feelings, I'm saying two different things. If you want to work in the context of theories where the Higgs mass is not calculable, I'm even happy to say, in those theories, I don't think I won't even talk about the hierarchy problem because it's not a well-defined question in those theories, right? We all agree on that, and all I'm saying is that the extra statement that maybe it's legitimate to ignore it because God knows what's going on up there with gravity. There are no particles. That's wrong. There definitely are particle states up there. We have, you know, unless you think objects that weigh 1,000 M Planck are some, you know, some. What are they? You know, you, yeah.
So, I mean, have particle. You have states, right? You have amplitude. Look at the gravitational scattering. You have a scale in the scattering. There's a scale where the scattering phase becomes of order one. How do you describe that physics? It's not that associated to a scale.
So this is.
Just one more thing. I'll just give one as one funny example of unnaturalness that I've recently run into. That actually Lance Dixon was telling me about. Just to give a funny example of something that might happen. So he and his friends have been computing. It doesn't even matter what it is. It's something in n equals four scattering amplitudes. Okay, there's some function. You can compute it at two loops, three loops, four loops, infinite loops at strong coupling. And so it's some function of some kinematic variable. Let's call it u. And you normalize call the function f of u. You normalize it to f of 1. So you plot f of u divided by f of 1. Okay? And so it all passes through 1 at u equals 1. So you have a bunch of curves. Okay? And you stare at the curves at two loops, three loops, four loops. They all look like they're converging uniformly to something as this parameter u heads towards zero. So by I, it looks like they're all converging to something. And if you zoom in around there, yeah, even it continues by I to look like they're all the same. So you think for some reason there's a universal behavior as u goes to zero. And in fact, it does go like, you know, some number times log squared u, something like that, with some number out in front. But when you look in extreme detail, you see that the coefficient out in front is not the same. It's not the same at one loop, two loop, three loop, and infinite loop. In fact, they're not the same. They all happen to be within sub a percent of each other. For no good reason, as far as anyone can tell. You can compute them analytically, and analytically, they're funny. They involve funny combinations of rational prefactors and zeta functions and things like that. So they're absolutely bizarre near identities between rational prefactors and zetas and so on, which for some reason make all these things within sub-percent of each other. This is not something anyone has any explanation for, but it's an example. It's a concrete example of the sort of thing that I was saying. It's an output, physical output of a theory. It's not an identity, it's not a symmetry, but there's something which is putting all these parameters within sub-percent of each other. So part of the reason why we all tolerate percent level, I mean, when I also said in my talk, we've seen percent level accidents in nature. Part of the reason we tolerate percent level is we all have the vague feeling of a look elsewhere effect of that order. We've looked at hundreds of things, you know, how it's not that strange, right? But in this case, I suspect that this case is a little more interesting because that there's probably some reason why all these things are within sub-percent of each other that we haven't discovered yet. So now it's a very long way to go from that to a theory for explaining such level cancellations for the Higgs. But I'm just saying that's equally a possibility, which would be I think more rational than many of the things that are being discussed.
Can I make a nasty comment? Okay, so now many of you spent 20, 10, 30 years now waiting for LHC. Next, there is the experimental result that you don't like. So now you have Ratazzi doing fluids, Slava doing conformal field theory. You are doing amplitudes. Okay.
Can I? Yeah, I'm going to be very brief, right?
Okay.
I'm going to be very brief. Oh. Sorry, can you put your screen back on, please? I just want to make a comment by paper by Dubovsky, which you mentioned, right?
I cannot.
No, you cannot. So Dubovsky wrote this paper, right? And you see, I just read this paper, and I think there is the value of that paper is that it makes Nima your comment. You have to be careful when you say calculable. So I think the main point of that paper is that the model that he discusses, to that model the word calculable is not applicable. You should come up with a different term, constructible or something like that. So the point of that paper is that they present a model in which you can couple a field theory to two-dimensional gravity by giving an explicit construction of an amplitude, a very simple explicit construction which does not involve any complicated cancellations or anything. You just write the formula. By virtue of this constructibility, you would be hard-pressed to say that there is some fine-tuning going on. And yet the final amplitude contains this disparity of scales. So it may be that we should even look for a new language. What we mean really by calculable. You can't. You can't couple standard model to gravity by the same trick. What do you mean? You wouldn't be able to do this without making the computation. Well, he does it by just writing the formula.
But in the end of the day, the invariant question is, are there a consistent set of amplitudes with any value of the Higgs map? The answer is yes. There's yes in his theory.
Well, in one case, it's given by non-transparent mathematics, which comes out at the end of the day. No, but wait a second. But that's what John said. No, that's what John said, right? That's what John said. But it's not an interesting object if you have to do it convoluted.
Yeah, who cares about that's so.
But in any case, I don't want to advocate his paper. But I think it just requires that we may not use the right language. There may be a different way of discussing this problem. It's still a third language, right? I'll stop here.
Hey. Let me just make like 20 seconds comment, because that's something I promised to. I just don't know the Jan's thing. By the way, the three people I thank, I mean, it was really, really visionary. It was a really great, great talk. I enjoyed. But I just don't think, or I don't know if I agree with the naturalness makes sense only in the context of multiverse, which is related with Nima's second point. I don't, because naturalness, it's certainly true that the naturalness makes sense only in the context of ensemble, for sure. Okay, I agree with that. But of course, that ensemble need not be, of course, physical. Okay, certainly this concept makes sense even in a unique theory, if it coupled to the principle that there is no, this is a strong statement, God is not playing a role here. If you couple with that statement, then of course, even if in a single theory, of course, then what the people were imagining, Ricardo were imagining, the superparticle must be found. So the concept does not require multiverse. It's a different concept. It's not totally an important comment, I hope, but that's just.
I think that your model is dead, because if you compute the threshold correction from the ghost, you get a big correction to the Higgs mass.
I, his answer.
Okay. this is what
the computer. Okay.
No, but.
No,
it's not so easy. Not so easy. No, it's not clear. No.
Okay, on this disagreement, I think we can close the discussion. Let's thank Gian, Riccardo, Alessandro, and everybody again. Just wait a moment, please.